The theory of evolution claims that LUCA, the last universal common ancestor, is the ancestor of every living creature that lives today that have evolved through random mutation and natural selection. I have brought you today 7 paradoxes that make this assertion unreasonable. What are they? Let's explore. Before we find out what the paradoxes are, we need to understand a little more about DNA, RNA, enzymes, and viruses. First, when we look at the life forms around us today, we are struck by a fact. Despite there are 2 types of genetic material, which are DNA and RNA, every kind of living organism that is self-replicating is based on DNA exclusively. We have things like viruses, of which are RNA-based viruses, but they are considered by many scientists as not living. Why? Because they cannot replicate themselves. They need to hijack the machinery of a living DNA-based host to complete their life cycle. What is so special about DNA? Well, the first thing, DNA is made of 2 strands that are matched to each other, so it has resilience. As we saw in a previous episode, when an error, for example, during replication takes place, you can use one of the strands to know that the other copied strand has an error and then correct it, which is mismatch detection. We have also seen that the DNA polymerase machinery has proofreading. We have also seen that even a living cell that is just has completed replication and is living is subjected to so many mutations every day. Do you know how much? 10,000 to 1 million mutations per cell per day due to external factors. And all of this is fixed by the DNA damage repair ingenious mechanisms. On the other hand, viruses do not enjoy these features. RNA is just one single strand in the majority of its forms. There is double-stranded RNA, but the majority that we're talking about is the single-stranded RNA. RNA polymerase is extremely error-prone, and you don't have an extra strand to do the comparisons and hence do mismatch repair. For example, a virus that is attacking a cell will have mutation rate that is 1 million times the mutation rate of its host cell. Obviously, we all know that viruses mutate very fast due to this. They also attenuate. Some have had the observation that the viral genome, when the virus is RNA-based, is quite short. And some have related this to the fact that a short genome with the huge mutation rate of viruses and the absence of error correction will at least give the virus better chances to survive mutation because, you know, the genome is small. So even when the mutation rate is 1 per 10,000, if it's like 10 or 20,000 long, then it will have 1 or 2 mutations by the time it's finished replication. However, still the mutation rate is huge. Let me tell you something, for example, about DNA-based life. If a virus attacks a cell and it attacks the DNA or causes damage to the DNA of the cell will immediately start repairing its DNA. If the viral damage to the DNA is too big, this can trigger the cell to commit suicide. It will kill itself. It will start a process called apoptosis. To prevent its damaged or deformed DNA from being replicated and hence have a deceased cell spreading. This is how resilient DNA is. Let's also look about to the relation between DNA and RNA. So DNA-based life will not go from DNA to protein in one jump. So first, you have an enzyme that will read the DNA and transcribe it to become RNA. And then RNA, which is also genetic material, will get another enzyme that will splice it and remove what is called introns. And then the final material, the messenger RNA, will now be able to be translated into a protein by another enzyme. This protein that has resulted can be an enzyme of its own. So the DNA material needs an enzyme to be transcribed, and enzymes to translate the RNA, and enzyme to splice the RNA, and the product might itself be an enzyme. Raises a question. If we need DNA to evolve through evolution, did DNA exist first without the enzymes? Or did enzymes exist first without the DNA? Because for DNA, you need the enzymes, otherwise you will go nowhere. And for enzymes, you need the DNA, otherwise where are you going to get them from? So, okay, let's put that aside now. Now, RNA is hence part of the life process. And RNA is simpler than DNA. It doesn't have all those sophisticated mechanisms. So scientists thought, with this huge sophistication of DNA-based genetics, it is unreasonable that the first primordial life forms were a primordial cell that has DNA at its core, because there's nothing primordial really about DNA. It is a sophisticated system. And let me surprise you, every DNA-based living cell has error correction mechanisms. So we don't have this, you know, like DNA that degrades and suffers huge amounts of errors like RNA. So scientists thought, okay, if this is the case, and since evolution is about things happening gradually, especially that mutations, random mutations, are the primary mechanism for novelty, then we should find primordial life starting from the simpler form, which is RNA. So they thought, if abiogenesis, which is the process of creating life from non-life, which is not part of the theory of evolution really, but part of the whole concept, if it created primordial life from dead chemicals, then this primordial life should be a primordial protocell that has RNA at its core. And then the cell would replicate and replicate and replicate until we reach to LUCA, that is the root of the tree of evolution, that then branches and spreads into all the life forms that we know about today. So scientists, many scientists, would think that LUCA was an RNA-based cell. I will take this line of thought, because really it doesn't make a difference if LUCA was RNA or DNA, because if we say that LUCA was DNA, then we need to think, how did LUCA became a DNA cell from its precursor RNA life forms that we know nothing about? So it will remain the same question. So just to be focused, we take the opinion that LUCA was an RNA-based life. And now for the paradoxes. So number one, if LUCA was an RNA-based life form, given the huge mutation rate and instability and vulnerability of RNA, how did it survive in the first place to the extent that it became the robust root of the tree of life from which everything else branched? And number two, if LUCA was an independently living life form, how come the only quasi-life form based on RNA that we see today, which is viruses, are not independent creatures and cannot self-replicate? And this is why scientists, many of them, consider them not living in the first place. Number three, if the speculation of some scientists that maybe LUCA had evolved error correction mechanisms that are RNA-based, like those that our DNA life today have. So the question is, if that is the case, and LUCA had RNA base with error correction. And let's assume that a clad, a branch of LUCA, evolved into the DNA side. How come another branch did not evolve the RNA life, which was existing and stable enough, with error correction? You know, evolutionists insist that if an ancestor branches into a specific clad that is better from an aspect, it does not mean that the ancestor will go extinct. For example, they would tell you that humans have a great ape ancestor, but that does not mean that you do not find any great apes. An ancestor can branch from one side to humans and from the other side still branch into chimpanzees. In their point of view, there is no contradiction. So where are the independently living RNA-based life that has error correction? If at all LUCA was RNA-based with error correction and evolved through random mutation and natural selection. Number five, we have seen that DNA needs enzymes and enzymes need DNA. So if LUCA, which was RNA-based, evolved into DNA, which evolved first? Did it evolve the enzymes, but then the enzymes needed the DNA, or did it evolve the DNA, but then the DNA needed the enzymes? And number six, if LUCA, which was RNA-based, evolved into DNA one way or the other, we may assume that this DNA in the beginning did not have error correction, and then it evolved error correction. So question, how would a DNA life that starts without error correction survive in the first place? And then, number seven, if we assume also, again, that DNA life evolved gradually one way or the other, and enzymes evolved, co-evolved with DNA, and error correction came into place after some time with the evolution of the enzymes that do the error correction gradually. Okay? So we start with DNA life that does not have error correction, and then we end with DNA life with the enzymes that do error correction that exist. Another question now. If the DNA life, the first one, was there without error correction, where today is DNA life that does not have error correction? Using the same principle that evolutionists insist on again, that the development of a new clad from an ancestor does not necessitate the extinction of the ancestor. Let me surprise you, every DNA life that we have today has error correction as a basic feature. I have told you these seven paradoxes. So are you still convinced that life came from abiogenesis, started into RNA, and then there was a LUCA that became the trunk of the tree for every sort of life? The theory of evolution has great challenges and paradoxes to even bypass the very root of life, the first step after this root. I leave you with those questions and paradoxes to give me your questions for our coming live stream. Until then, see you soon. Assalamu alaikum. Peace be upon you all.